following interview was conducted with Charles M. Ernstman, Professor Emeritus of Mechanical Engineering for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Monday, September 17, 2007, at his office on the Purdue campus. The interviewer is Catherine Marquis, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a bit about where you were born and your parents and your early years in school.
Well, I was born in Elkhart, Indiana, and my father, first generation U.S. My grandfather came from Alsace-Lorraine on his side, and on my mother's side, she was Swedish, and her parents both came from Sweden to settle here, and so she was a first generation U.S. citizen, and I've spent all of my early years.
You went to school there?
And, yeah.
Mm-hmm. What did your father do?
He was a machinist on the railroad, New York Central Railroad.
Okay.
And he was also a union steward. The IAM was the union they had up there. And when I got connected with Aerojet later, they organized the union. I had a sounding board that I could talk to on union matters, my dad. And, so we used to do that.
Sure. But can you tell us what year you were born in?
What's that?
What year were you born?
Oh, early.
Okay, all right. And then you went to grade school and high school? What was the size of the high school? Did you go to that high school?
The high school was Elkhart High School. Mm-hmm. Pardon me, it was the only high school in town. I can't remember the total population, but it was 1,500 and something in that order of students.
And then tell us how you came to Purdue?
Well, World War II started, and so I went into service.
What branch did you serve in?
Started out in the infantry in the 30th Division. I wanted to get into the Air Corps, so I transferred to the Air Corps and went to cadet training in Buffalo at Canisius College. And I think that's what introduced me to the college life. It was really nice. And when I came out of the service, well, while I was in the service, I tried to save money to go to Tri-State, as I've indicated. Then when I came out, the GI Bill came along, so why go to Tri-State when I could go to Purdue? So I came to Purdue then at that point and took mechanical engineering.
Okay.
And
did you live on campus?
I lived off campus with a family by the name of Hitchings. He was a manual arts teacher at Jeff. And got me some part-time employment teaching drafting, because I had had some drafting experience before I came to Purdue. And so I taught a high school class for two semesters to earn money.
Sure.
And then we boarded at Mrs. Creeble's. I don't know whether you are acquainted with Bob Creeble.
I recognize the name.
Yeah, he's a son. Play basketball on West Side. We played basketball after meals in the alley. Like I said, I never eat so many elbows in my life. But she was an excellent person.
What was the campus like during that? What was the campus like? Not very many more males, not very many females, I think.
No. They were down to, I think, I can remember a number 1 in 4, but I think it was even lower than that at the time I was undergrad.
Were there any females in your mechanical engineering?
I can't remember any in the classes I had. Later, of course, it changed quite a bit.
What was your career path then afterwards? Did you go on for graduate work?
Well, I graduated from...
What year did you graduate?
Completed my undergraduate work in 1949.
Okay.
And then I was very interested in aircraft propulsion, either air breathing or rockets, and the opportunity presented itself to study under Zucro, who was a specialist in both areas. And so I was admitted into graduate school and
here at Purdue.
Took my graduate work here. And at the time, the offices were over in the hangar at the airport. And we had one building out here, which happens to be the one at the end of the road here now, which is still there. And, that was the whole affair. President Hovde set aside this land for the lab because it was remote, although they're building in around us now quite a bit, but because of the hazardous rocket work.
And then what, continue on, then what was the next steps? A little bit that you would...
Well, then when I graduated in 1951 from the propulsion course, I got a job with Aerojet in Azusa, California. And at that time, that was the only plant they had. And since then, it's been expanded twice fold. But in any event, I went to work in the test area at Azusa and worked as a test engineer, mainly working on starting systems with non-self-igniting propellants. So we had glow plugs, which were heated up very hot, and then we'd spray propellant on them. And that would make a torch that we would run into the rocket engine and light it, because the propellants were not self-igniting. Up to that point, pretty much all of the rockets used were used propellants that were self-igniting. All you had to do was bring them together and they would react. But the Air Force wanted to get non-reactive, so we were using white fuming nitric acid and jet fuel. And this is where I learned to train a man behind me, because I had a chance for promotion and I was turned down because I was the only individual that knew anything about starting white fuming nitric acid JP engines. And so I had to miss that, and I immediately set about to train a replacement. So the next opportunity came, I was able to move. And so I eventually wound up at Aerojet in charge of what they call the thrust chamber group. So we developed rocket combustion chambers for bigger systems. And that was a subgroup. They had a controls group, and systems group, and then the thrust chamber group, and I was in charge of it. And then moved on up to the systems group, which then started firing rocket systems, that's the pumps, and the whole rocket assembly that eventually goes into space. And I became the head of that group. Systems that Aerojet provided. did, that's the one, what they call the service module engine that slowed the module down in food orbit, and then they had to fire to kick it out of food orbit. And I remember that was always a cause for concern. We had to have a standby group that could support that engine operation. And they use it for mid-course correction. So as it went from the Earth to the Moon, sometimes they had to make small corrections, and they'd use our engine to do that. Mm-hmm. And then when they got into Moon orbit, they had to fire to slow down in Moon orbit. And then to come out, they had to fire behind the Moon. So we never could tell whether it operated okay till it came out behind the Moon and had the right velocity. So that was always a little
touching. Sure.
But I really didn't enjoy that job nearly as much as I did the earlier ones, because I was now supervising people instead of doing engineering, which to me was
more
appealing. And listening to people tell me that their supervisor spoke harshly to them and this sort of thing was irritating, rather than dealing with engineering problems. So I wasn't really happy in that job. And I had the opportunity, as I, Sucro, Professor Sucro used to visit the aerospace industries on the West Coast. And whenever he did that, usually the grads from the lab would get together and we'd have a dinner. And Sucro at one of these in 1964 asked me if I'd be interested in coming back. They had gotten $7.5 million grant for a laboratory from NASA, and wanted if I'd be interested in coming back and helping them build it. And I would love that, because I've spent so many years adapting existing facilities to doing special tests where I could start with a piece of flat ground and really get some original ideas. And I said I was interested, but I had to talk to my management and see if I could possibly have to leave. At the time, we were just getting started on working on NERVA, which was a nuclear rocket program. And I had very little nuclear engineering experience, so I thought maybe what I could do is take a couple courses when I came back to Purdue to help out with the lab design. Profit both of them, and the company then agreed to pay half my wage, and Purdue paid half. And I came back for a year, and then we didn't quite get the job done, so I had to ask for a 6-month extension, which I got from both parties, and then we finally got the first couple firings off, and all the systems were okay. NASA approved the facility, and it was operable, and so we were pleased. And then Zucro said that he could have the possibility of getting me a professorship. And also, I guess what got me going on that was that he had asked me to do a design project, or excuse me, teach a design course, since I had that sort of experience. So I taught that for during the 6-month period I had an extension on, and I just loved it, to be able to work with students and see the lights coming on, and it was just a good experience. And then Zucro indicated that he might be able to give me a professorship, and so I talked to my plant management, because I was committed to go back there, and I planned to do that. And they said if I could replace myself in kind, that they would let me go. And as I said earlier, I trained a person behind me in every position I moved, so I had a man set up, and so I offered his name as a suggestion, and then he said they'd try it for 6 months. If it worked out okay, I could stay at Purdue. If not, I would come back. And as it turned out, it worked out okay. In fact, I left on such favorable ground that 2 years later, when they stopped a major part of the operations at Azusa testing, moved them up to Sacramento. There's a lot of surplus equipment. So they sent me a letter and invited me to come out and pick over the bones, as it were. And so I brought back, this would probably be about 1968 or so, about $70,000 worth of equipment, which we could use here.
Sure.
At the laboratory. So
very nice.
It turned out to be a good experience.
You're talking about students you've enjoyed. How do students changed over time, do you think?
Well, the time at least that I was involved, I think they were pretty constant and really interested in getting an education. And the fact that you could give them actual working experience really, I think, turned them on more.
Sure, right, okay. You had some changes in the schools. Who was the head when mechanical? You have served under several heads in mechanical engineering.
Yes. Professor we'll have to dig into that.
That's okay. Okay. But then you had
when I came back, I think Professor Solberg was.
Okay. But then there were several presidents that you. Hubdy was the president when you.
Hubdy was the president.
Sure.
Then, yeah.
Okay. And then Hansen and.
Yeah, and he was the instrument. When we built the lab and dedicated it, Hubdy was the university president. Came out with the dedication.
Okay. How did they happen to name, this was not named Zukok in the laboratories, how did that come about?
Well, we...
And when was that done, do you know?
Yeah, that's fairly recent,
okay.
As you're probably aware. The Professor Hoffman, myself, Professor Osborne all thought that'd be okay to honor Zucro because he was instrumental in founding the lab. I mean, he worked out the arrangement with President Hubbard to get the lab, the building, and with the Navy as well. They both participated in the University and Navy. And I think that
they named the laboratories. This was.
So we thought it'd be appropriate to name it that way. And so I got some letters from Bernie Dorman, who was a graduate with Zucro, and received an honorary doctorate from Purdue. And I thought he would have a little weight with the president, President Bering at the time.
Okay.
And then Jerry Ross, who was an astronaut, and he agreed to write a letter as well.
Sure.
And so we had several key people who were making the recommendation to rename it after Zucro. So we submitted that down to the university administration, and they accepted it.
Mm-hmm. Are there any members of the family still around? Did any people for the ceremony?
Of Zucro?
Zucro.
He's
passed away, though, has he not?
Yeah, he's passed away. Now, when we had the 50th celebration, the 50th anniversary of the laboratory,
okay.
That's when we announced the change of name, and Mrs. Zucro was there. She now since passed away. Bernie Dorman gave a talk at that presentation. And let's see, I guess it would be Zucro's daughter from there and her son, all of the Zucro family.
Mm-hmm.
And Zucro had passed away before that.
Before that. That's very nice, yes. Okay. Tell us what...
Mrs. Zucro was, I thought, just a wonderful person. When I was a student, I asked a question of Doc one time, and he said, well, why don't you come out to the house? They lived on North 9th Street. And he said, I'll help you out there. I said, okay. So I went out there, and they had one of these doors with the kind of offset windows. Normal people would be quite tall enough to look in the window, but I was. And here comes Mrs. Zucro, right after I rang the doorbell, running out of the dining room, jumped on a throw rug, slid across the front room, and opened up the door and says, come on in. She was that kind of person. When she was back for the 50th anniversary, I reminded her.
We don't forget, right?
Yeah.
Were you ever a faculty fellow at any of the residence halls on campus during the time you were here? Were you ever a faculty fellow at the residence halls? What have you been, and now that you're emeritus, what have you been in special activities? What sort of things have you been involved in?
Well, one of the activities that I've been involved with is writing papers on rocket history. And so I've done that for several of the companies that haven't been explored in depth in the industry. And so I've done it for, of course, Aerojet, which I was involved with initially, and that was kind of easy to do. But done it for General Electric. Bell, Buffalo, and well, let's see, I guess
that's pretty good. That's right. Very, and then they keep that helps the history of the company.
Yeah.
Which is great. So you're doing some preservation there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's exactly it. Now, and I enjoy doing it because
sure.
I get in touch with some people that were involved with it. Although, I'm finding out quite often that there are a few people left that contact, but so far I've been successful.
So far you've been successful, yeah, right, okay. Getting an outstanding event in your life, if I ask you that,
what's that?
An outstanding event that comes to mind?
God.
So many, it's hard to think. How about family? Do you have children and...
I have four children and eight grandchildren, and of which two completed mechanical engineering in Florida, and that pleased me a lot. Another one completed their teaching degree at Purdue,
okay. And
they're teaching school down in Indianapolis. One of them completed nurses training and is working as a nurse over at the Frankfurt Hospital with a doctor, I guess, as well.
That's very. Did you meet your wife here at Purdue?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So is she from around here, or where is she from?
She's from a farm about probably 6 to 8 miles from Lafayette.
Okay.
And took her to the county.
Okay.
And,
did she go to Purdue?
She went to Butler.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And,
that's all right.
Yeah. That's okay.
That's right.
And,
right.
She took zoology. And then in the midst of that, she decided she wanted to become a nurse. So she went to Indiana University in Indianapolis in the nurses training program, got registered as a nurse, worked down there, and I met her through a classmate of mine at Purdue, who was a sorority sister of hers in Butler, and they introduced us, and then kept going there.
There you go.
And found out that she was a local farm girl. Of course, I had no farm experience whatsoever, so her dad and brother kept me out of the barn because I was an irritant rather than
a help. Oh, dear. Anything that I didn't ask that you'd like to share with me for the researchers, anything that comes to your mind special?
Well, I think I've covered the part that I was most interested in was fact that the electronic age has really changed our lives in the education area. progressed tremendously, and I hope to continue to go in that direction, because like I was indicating to you earlier, the control room used to be made up of a whole flock of instruments, and now it's just a desk, a screen, and a keyboard to control an experiment.
Right. It's amazing, isn't it?
And it's amazing. It still amazes me.
Anything else that sort of takes care of it, you think you share pretty
well,
much?
Well, I think probably one of the things that is critical to our research area here is safety. We have to be very careful of how we handle propellants and so forth. We don't have any accidents. Fortunately, we have not had any.
One thing that comes to mind, you might want to mention that you've been involved with the Retirees Association.
Yes.
Yes.
I was chairman of the benefits committee for 2 periods, and we had to negotiate insurance, and we handled issues such as priority seating and athletic events and stuff for retirees. Juggling around trying to get the best rate for retirees.
Good experience.
Yeah,
yes,
it was
right.
Rather eye-opening.
Well, I want to thank you, Professor Ernstman. This has been just great. I really appreciate
it. Well, I hope
you have.